welcome to another episode of Altered States with Mr. Sports and Ron Fanto. What is up, brother? It's been a whole week since I've seen you.
Show what, number four?
This is show number four, and without further ado, let's get to our special guest right now, because he's kind enough to donate his time to us all the way out in North Carolina, my longtime friend for decades, Basil the comedian. How you doing, brother Basil?
Hey, man. How are you? And I just got to really love the technology. You know, I to be honest with you, John, I find here in North Carolina, if you get two gerbils on a wheel, that may help with your technological issues that you're having in Youngstown. But this is just me. You know, call me crazy. You know, either that or we go back to the two soup cans and the piece of string, and I'm sure that you guys have mastered that. To be quite honest.
We've got it down. Hey, whatever we have to do to make it work, we're making it work. Base, people want to know, when you're coming back to Northeast Ohio, of course, you know, we were a Y103. We sat Base a week for years, and it was a very popular segment. So when are you coming back to Northeast Ohio for all your fans?
I'm dying. I'm just jonesing to get back on stage. You have no idea how much I am jonesing. To be honest with you, I mean, look, I'm a phase three guy. I mean, any type of live entertainment, right? You know, instead of go, if you want to do a theater, do I really want, you know, people to be 6 feet apart? You know, not really.
That's true.
You know, I've had that early in my career. I don't need that now. I'd like to get them all together, you know, and actually have a concert where everyone is laughing. But, look, we can bitch and complain, right? But the thing is, we're alive. So we're good, and no one else is touring. I'm doing a lot of actual shows on the internet where I have, like, associations will go ahead and have me. I just did this one, and you and I were talking about it, I did this one for the Indian Asian women that had me on. It was hysterical, and I just went off, I know, for literally an hour. Just went off. Didn't even let them breathe. I did a little bit. They wanted to talk about something, but they love my Greek material because, remember, I have two shows, right? So I have the Greek, Growing Up Greek in America show, which is now the Benduza Palooza World Tour.
Yeah.
And then I got the new show that we have, and it's 1 Degree of Separation. And that's the new Basil tour that we're doing, so we're kind of excited about that. So we start off, and we already signed contracts for next year for Australia, so I'll be touring in Australia next year. I'll be gone for about 3.5 months, and then I'll do throughout Europe, and then we're supposed to be filming already the TV show. We got picked up by Netflix.
Wow.
So we're supposed to be filming here in Wilmington, and I'm like, really? We can't even get together to film because we need about roughly 50 to 60 people on the set to make sure that everything is done correctly. We can't even do that right now.
You know, Ron and I were talking, the temperature of this country is red hot, white hot, you might even say. Everybody is offended. Everybody seems like they want to get pissed off about something. Does that affect you in comedy now?
Not really, because, you know, if you know my show the way that you do, I've always been somewhat self-deprecating. Mm-hmm. So it's always on me. And if you're laughing, that means it happened to you without me saying that you guys are going through this and you guys know. They're looking at me going, oh, my God, I went through that too. And, you know, for me, I don't care if you're black. I don't care if you're Hispanic, Oriental, Asian. I don't care. You know, to me, it crosses all boards. And you know me, man. I mean, I get it from the womb to the tomb. So I have the very, very young to the very, very old that comes to my show. And I've never hit that one specific demographic that was something I was like, oh my God, I'm 25, I can watch this, but if I'm 35, I won't understand it. It's never been that way with me. So it's always been something like a lot of fun that I've always liked to do, and we keep on doing it. That's why it's kind of tough to always write material that everyone can get into. While it being self-deprecating, it's at the same time, I talk about my failures as a football player. I talk about my failures as, you know, going to law school, my failures on everything else, and everyone goes, oh, my God, I had failures, too. Now, the one thing I will say, John, is this. Since the corona pandemic has gone on, my yard has never looked as beautiful as it does now.
Of course not. Absolutely incredible. Hey, some people about a little bit about your background. I was telling Ronnie this ESPN 30 for 30 series. You got to do the voice of Jimmy the Greek Snyder, which was pretty impressive.
I did the voice. I got that was my first Emmy nod, by the way. I got nominated for an Emmy for that, for doing that. And there's a couple of, believe it or not, a couple of new ones came out for boxing that they've asked me to go ahead and portray the voice aspect of, to portray the boxers. And so I can't really go into that. I was asked not to really speak on that until, you know, I can give you names and numbers and all that type of stuff when it comes out. But the movie is being shot right now, or the show is being shot. One is for 30 for 30, and the one is independent. So I get a chance to do that. And, of course, you know, the voice work is going to keep me going, hopefully, for a long, long time. And I love doing that. To be honest with you, I've had many opportunities to do more stuff. I do the voice of Bullwinkle Moose for Universal Studios.
For a long time.
And I've been doing, for a long time, 17 years now I've been doing that. There are no new Bullwinkle cartoons, as you may know. What I do is I fixed the old ones many years ago when it was owned at that time by another company. It wasn't owned by Universal. And so what I did was I wound up doing it, fixing it, and then they do stuff for Universal Park System now, type of commercials, or, hey, if you want to find something else, make sure you go to the concession stand, you know, so stuff like that.
I love that. And you also do the genie. It's part of your act. Those have seen the...
Well, I sang for Aladdin for Disney. Did that for Aladdin. It was pretty cool. Buena Vista owned the rights to Bullwinkle in the early days. Then they sold it off to Universal. But doing the thing that I did for Disney when Robin Williams at that time was suing Disney because he didn't think he got enough money because of the great success that, Aladdin had commercial success, so he wanted more money, so they put a TRO, a temporary restraining order, not to use his stuff all the way through.
Wow.
So I sang Friend Like Me on there for the Christian Yamaguchi on Ice special, so that was pretty cool.
And Ron made fun of my Keith Jackson impersonation, but you do a pretty good job.
It's the worst.
Very good Keith Jackson.
It's the worst, Basil.
Yeah, it was kind of funny. It was like,
it's the worst
I can't
ever.
Yeah. Oh my, this is Keith Jackson for ABC Sports. The 6'2" Negro linebacker from Temple, Florida, and wow, did he take a licking? So he was so descriptive, and I used to sit there and laugh, and it was hysterical. And when we would do things, because I also had the syndication, I was the voice of James Brown calling in from prison during the OJ trials. Good God Almighty, this is James Brown. You know, I was always the biggest kick out of doing that. And I covered the OJ trials for over a year. And, you know, I was on syndicated radio shows. And then the big thing was making sure I was on the Rick D's countdown, and I would do it every week for them. And then my syndicators was WPLJ out of New York, so I would just go ahead and do the stuff for them. A greatest story about that, when I would do James Brown, I didn't have the office like you see now and stuff. You know, this is a separate building about 7 miles from my home, and I love my office. I truly do. But I was doing a lot of the voice work, and like you, you know, we found whatever we could, and I would put up blankets in the corner of the garage. I have like a 2.5-car garage, put blankets in there, and I would scream out James Brown at 4 o'clock in the morning to the syndicators, and I forgot that my poor brother-in-law and his wife were staying with us because they were moving into their new house that wasn't ready. So all of a sudden, I jump up at 4:30 in the morning, 4 o'clock, jump back, kids, I found it. The J.E. Brown with another OJ trials update. Let me tell you, white people, what went down. All of a sudden, I hear this heavy step going down because it was right above me. Where all of a sudden, hear boom, 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 and he comes in, looks in the garage, and goes, "What the F is happening? What the hell are you doing?" I always felt that he deserves hazard pay for all the crap that he went through while he was standing with us for that month.
Bass, people love you, and like you said, you make fun of everybody. You're self-deprecating most of all. And, you know, you talk about what it was like growing up Greek and, you know, the lunches that your mother would pack for you and that you had, everybody had a pet when they were a kid and you had goldfish or you had fish.
And yeah. No, I actually, my mom would make, like, you know, sautéed calves brains for me. Now, I love sautéed calves brains, but not for lunch in high school, you know. So that was, I thought it was a Tupperware. You know, Tupperware used to make this thing which looked like for a sandwich, right? It was a square thing like that for a sandwich. And all of a sudden, next thing you know, but it was kind of weighty. I'm like, ah, Mom must have really loaded up the meat in this sandwich, right? All of a sudden, I pull it out of my lunch bag, and I open it up. I'm like, guys, I'll be right back. I had to go to the teacher's lounge and eat this because even my teachers didn't understand. They thought we were cannibals or something like that. But that's what I, you know, I love eating. I love the Greek thing. I mean, we eat, you know, the kidneys and we eat the hearts and we eat the head of the lamb. It's stuff very, very tender. It's very delicious. It just sounds rather disgusting and gross. You know, that I'll never forget when my father brought home, you know, a lamb and two goats, like 3 days before Greek Easter. And we had a stupid dog, and this stupid dog of ours, his name was Little Zorba. And, you know, and for 3 days, Little Zorba, the lamb, and the two live goats, and I know it was a lamb and two live goats, but my stupid dog, Zorba, Little Zorba's going, oh my God, look at these dogs, they're strange. One is very white and fluffy, and the other two have horns coming out of their head. So for 3 days, they're eating, they're frolicking, they're sleeping with each other. Then came Sunday, Easter Sunday, and all of a sudden the dog sees the lamb and the two live goats spinning on a spit cooking, right? And Little Zorba comes up to me and looking up, he's like, ever since then, most well-behaved animal I've ever had in my life.
I love it. Bass, thanks for taking time out of your busy schedule. Everybody in Northeast Ohio and Western Pennsylvania, can't wait to see you again. Love you, brother.
Hey, dude, man, I love you. And, John, you and I have so many great stories that I don't even know if we could share on the air.
Oh, yeah.
But some of the stuff that we did on radio was groundbreaking. I'm proud of it. I'm proud of the stuff that we did. Keith Jackson singing. Singing. I saw Mama kissing Santa Claus.
Go on, give me a little bit on the way out.
You would like to hear a little bit of that?
A little bit on the way out.
I saw Mama kissing Santa Claus. And it wasn't no ordinary Santa Claus. It was the linebacker from Ohio State.
My brother, thank you so much.
Thank you, Basil.
Hey, well, listen, guys, thank you all so much for having me. Loving kisses, and I'll talk to you all soon. And I'm so sorry that I screwed up all the audio.
That's Basil, the comedian, world-loved and absolutely fabulous. Always a pleasure to see him on Altered States with Mr. Sports and Ron Fantone. Well, Rob, we're going to get into a discussion. You see this little hat here?
Yes.
This was outlawed a while ago. Chief Wahoo.
Outlawed.
Outlawed, per se. Now there's talk that the Indians are going to change their name. And I don't really have a problem with the name of the Indians, you know, itself. I can understand how this might be deemed offensive, but I got to tell you, first ball game I went to, Old Municipal Stadium, I saw this on top of a Municipal Stadium scoreboard. I'm 5 years old. I just thought it was the coolest thing, and I thought that way for decades. I certainly found no offense in it. Again, I'm not Native American, but I got to tell you, I wore this with pride.
Man, you are rambling.
I'm rambling a little bit today.
I forgot what we were talking about. You know, I really did. I'm like,
what's some kind of a hat? Name change.
Some kind of a hat. No, the thing with the Indians, it surprises me too, John. It surprises me about the Indians because I didn't think the name was offensive. But then again, I'm not Native Americans, I wouldn't know how that feels. There's so many different aspects of it. There's so many different things going on. There's so many, like you had mentioned when we had Basil on, which, by the way, it was great stories, great impersonations. But the thing with the Indians is, I think it's time. I think it's time to.
So you're okay with the Cleveland Spiders and they call Progressive Field the web, and everything's going to be spider, like Black Widow Alley, Tarantula Lane.
Yeah, you know what I think?
Is this what you think?
I think if the Indians had a more illustrious history, I know this goes back to 1915. They were the Naps. They were the Spiders in the National League back in the 1800s. And I think my problem is I love the whole spider thing.
Do you really?
I'm not going to get political, or I'm not going to get, you know, this is right, that's wrong, or whatever. I'm going to stay away from that and just tell you, I love the spider concept, man. I like webbing in the outfield.
Well, I guess we could ask Richmond University about that, because that's their nickname. Hey, let's do an Altered States Ron Fantone, Mr. Sports, classic music pick of the week. And we'll take you to the summer of 1981. It was Jet Records. It's the LP time. This song hit number 10 on the Billboard charts in the United States. A verse on this tune is actually sung in French, if you can believe that or not.
No.
Meaning, hang on to your dream. The MTV video appearance was the most expensive at the time that was made. Features orchestral cellos and the synth sounds that Jeff Lynne and the Electric Light Orchestra are known for. Here's Hold On Tight and a little snippet of ELO.
Hold on tight to your dream.
ELO 1981, Hold On Tight, but they had so many hits. And you know, Ronnie, Jeff Lynne finally put them back in concert. It was less than a year ago, and I had so many friends that went to see ELO and Jeff Lynne. And I didn't pay for it because I thought the tickets were too expensive. The pictures that came back and the reviews were just amazing. I wish I'd gone.
Why would you pass that up?
I don't know. And I may never get a chance again.
You know this is true. I am the only Y103 disc jockey who played ELO's Rollover Beethoven 13 minutes, 55 seconds, and I got in trouble every time I did it.
That's because you had to go to the bathroom probably bad.
Yeah, I got in trouble every time I did it.
Hey, last week, too, we debuted a segment on the show, a little trivia, Altered States Mystery Challenge of the Week, and you gave three scant clues, which you're going to do again this week, and we're going to have you reveal the answer for last week before giving three new clues.
What if I forgot it?
Hold on.
Okay, last week. Is that...
There he is. You called him a...
That is absolutely...
A heavy-headed man.
Yes. This gentleman, okay, his name was made fun of. That was clue number one.
On national TV.
On national TV by a prominent football announcer. And, a color announcer. And also, he had a very short career.
Yeah, it was all with the Cleveland Browns.
All with the Cleveland Browns.
And he had a touchdown.
Yes, that could have changed football history. Because this touchdown, had the game ended this way, you would have not seen all the years that have gone by of all the cork popping and the champagne and the Miami Dolphins, because the Browns would have defeated them in 1972.
It was 14-13 after this gentleman's 27-yard touchdown reception from then Mike Phipps, who had a horrible game. Browns ended up losing 20-14. But that world-famous announcer made fun of his name. Who was that?
This was Don Meredith. And Dandy Don, when they were talking about this gentleman, who is Fair Hooker, said he never met one.
And I believe that was on the opening telecast when the Browns took on the Jets.
Absolutely was.
With Joe Namath at the old stadium.
For those of you that got Fair Hooker, you're outstanding Browns fans. Congratulations.
And he played his entire career with the Browns, 69 through 74, about five or 6 years. So Fair Hooker had some impressive moments in his short tenure with the Cleveland Browns. How about this week's question, brother?
We have one this week?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. This gentleman acquired his nickname. Now, he resembles a very famous TV star. Yeah, I'll throw in from the 1960s.
That could be okay. One of thousands.
He was a one month sensation with the tribe, with the Spiders, with the Indians.
Spiders. Put the Spiders on. Hammy's going to call the Spiders game. Right. I'll never get used to that. I'm sorry.
And sadly, after a lengthy coaching career, he sadly passed away from the same disease that claimed Lou Gehrig's disease.
ALS.
ALS, yes.
Absolutely.
If you know this gentleman, you can put his name down in the topics or in comments.
You got to hold him up, bro, in high esteem. Name this mystery challenge guest.
Yes, name this mystery challenge guest. Our shirts are about the same color.
I'm trying to think what TV actor he looks like. Well, actually, I know the answer. You know, we were talking about the Indians in a name change. You're for the Spiders. Okay, it's going to take some getting used to. I think if my dad were still here, you know, and he prided himself on the 48 and the 54 Indians so much, I don't think he'd like this at all. I'm like, what the hell's going on? I never looked at the Indians' name in any offensive. Again, I'm not Native American, but I got to tell you, I had a pride with their Chief Wahoo, the name of the Indians, and I thought, I never thought that they were made fun of in jest. I always thought that they were heralded and talked about, and it was a way of remembering.
You talked about being a kid and following the Indians, and you're like me and a lot of folks are. We felt a lot different about baseball back then. There was a purity to it. There was a beauty to it. The Cleveland Indian mascot. I remember going to an Indian game with my dad and coming back with a Chief Wahoo bobblehead. That, to me, was a symbol of my childhood, a symbol of my favorite baseball team, basically a caricature. I never once, and there aren't 5, 6, 7, and 8-year-old kids to think, oh, that's a slam on a certain culture or whatever, because they haven't been taught that hatred yet.
Yeah, that's true. I talked about my debut ball game with my dad in 68 going to see the Oakland A's, and I can remember walking into that Mammoth Stadium and seeing there's that green field, and it looked like the Roman Coliseum, and all the lights were on, and I was like, wow. But that Chief Wahoo stadium, that's what got me into the Indians. And I wore this Chief with pride for a long time, and I was proud to be a Cleveland Indians fan. Think about the movie Major League, Ronnie. I mean, Cleveland Indians, Cleveland Spiders are not going to be the same.
No.
There's something to history. I'm a traditionalist always.
And there's a sadness here. But when you see it coming and the writing's on the wall, you kind of just got to make the best of it. Because there's so many, especially now, we shouldn't be concerned about team nicknames right now.
Yeah, there's a lot more important things on the horizon. Song pick number two is a former guest of mine. We'll take you back to 1977, Asylum Records. Joe Walsh provided a lot of guitar work on this album called Thunder Island. It was heard prominently throughout this LP on just about every track. We're going to play the title track, of course. Written by Jay about a girl that he spotted on an Hawaiian island who he ended up dating. Enjoy Jay Ferguson and a little snippet of Thunder Island on Altered States with Mr. Sports and Ron Fantone.
She was the color of the Indian sun.
And you know, Ronald, he was with Two Prominent Group before that, Spirit.
Yes.
Remember Mr. Skin, Where You Been? And he was also with a band called JoJo Gunn from Jerome. So that is the great One Then is Jay Ferguson on the solo circuit on Asylum Records in Thunder Island from 1977.
You are a wealth of information. Didn't he look like a magician Doug Henning in a couple of those shots?
I think I just saw
Doug Henning in a couple of those shots. He just looked a little bit like, you know, I was waiting for a rabbit to jump out of a hat or something. I don't know.
You know, we're talking about the Indians. It's a theme of it. And they're going to go back and play baseball in a 60-game schedule in a bubble. At the recording of this, Fran Mil Reyes has tested positive for COVID, and you're going to see more of this. You're going to see more players out. No fans. I don't know what this is going to look like. I don't know if it's going to be the game that has already been diluted in terms of entertainment, in my own personal view.
It's going to look like when the Indians played at Municipal Stadium.
Yeah, back in the day.
We're watching that way for years and years and years in front of a handful of fans, if any.
And, you know, we talked about 48 and 54, and then the most recent years.
95, 97.
Well, you know, 94, you know, strike cut us off. We were second behind the Chicago White Sox. 95, incredible. That was a shortened year, too. I think we went 144 losses to the Braves in the World Series. 97, who expected us to get there? Still upset about the trade of Kenny Lofton for Marquise Grissom. 07 was a hell of a year. We had the Boston Red Sox who would go on to sweep the Colorado Rockies in the World Series. We had them 3-1 in the American League Championship Series. We blew that. And at 16, a couple of years ago, against the Chicago Cubs, blowing a 3-1 series lead.
You know what?
But there's been some great memories in recent times for the Tribe.
But spider what? Time.
Spider time. You're done with Chief Wahoo. Let's put him away.
Spider time.
And, you know, I think about when I grew up and I started to really get into the Indians, Phil Segge wasn't like Trader Lane, but he traded a lot because Cleveland didn't have the payroll. Gabe Paul, Stover, Mileti, and those guys throughout the years. And we would have these stars and they would trade them off. Gaylord Perry.
Oh, yeah.
I remember us getting him for Sudden Sam McDowell. Then we traded him off to the Texas Rangers for Bibby, Jackie Brown, Rick Waits, and those guys. Chris Chambliss. We were a feeder program for the New York Yankees. We sent them Chambliss. We sent them Nettles. And Buddy Bell. I love Buddy Bell. And then all of a sudden, Segge trades him for Toby Hara, which didn't make any sense to me.
No, it didn't.
But he goes on to be an all-star. Dennis Eckersley was one that I never got over because him and Manning had a feud behind the scenes involving ex-wife. And the Indians traded Eck off to Boston. He wins 20 games in 1978.
Who were the guys that traded off the wives?
Kekich and Peterson.
Fritz Peterson?
Yeah, they swap wives. Do you remember that? Crazy times.
Well, I wasn't there or anything. Well, I'm going to remember that if I was there, though.
But Dave LaRoche, Jim Kern, George Hendrick, mm-hmm. Lenny Barker, Rick Sutcliffe, Vaughn Hayes, these are some of my favorite players throughout the years. And the Indians would always trade them away for a package of players. Song number three today, we'll take you back to...
Can I run something by you real quick?
What's that?
It just popped in my mind. If there's a name change, all this history you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
does that just become Indian history, or does the history of the ball club, the Cleveland Ball Club, continue?
Well, it's going to obviously continue. I mean, we can make progressive change and everything, but it doesn't rewrite history. It is what it is. It's etched in stone. You could change moving forward, but you can never go back and erase history. That's my thoughts on it. We'll take it in January of 1981. Columbia Records is from the LP Captured. This was mostly a live album recorded while on tour in the summer of 1980, just months prior. But this was a studio recording off a live album. Does that make any sense? Showcasing the brilliant vocals of one Steve Perry. The LP was dedicated to a good friend. His name was Bon Scott of AC/DC, who had recently passed away from asphyxiation. Enjoy a little snippet of a top 40 gem rarely heard anymore. Here's Journey featuring Steve Perry and The Party's Over, Hopelessly in Love on Altered States.
Just what more can I do?
know Steve Perry had some physical health problems. And voted one of the top 100 lead vocalists of all time. And you can find out why right there on that little gem. And you think about bands like Journey and Fleetwood Mac with Buckingham and the Knicks. And then you think about Journey with Steve Perry. Those bands were in existence before the arrival of those two. They weren't always like that. Journey was a much different band prior to Perry's arrival in late 77, early 78. And then before Buckingham and Knicks joined Fleetwood Mac, they were Peter Green guitar driven. They very different sound. Those guys made the bands once they emerged.
No doubt. A lot of changes over the years. And you know what's funny about Journey? They have that young Filipino, was he a Filipino gentleman or whatever that replaced Steve Perry?
They found him on YouTube. Of all places.
Just incredible. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was amazing that they could, because you would think, with a voice like Steve Perry, it's going to be really tough to replace, but he did a pretty good job.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, the amazing thing is, after he departed the band, for a variety of reasons, mostly health conditions reasons, they spent nearly a lifetime trying to find a sound-alike for Steve Perry,
yes.
Because he had defined the new Journey sound from what it had been prior. Before we get out of here, I also want to talk about the Washington Redskins. You know, I can understand, but I got to bring up one very interesting point. This is a name, you think of the legendary Sammy Baugh, you think of Billy Kilmer, George Allen, Sonny Jurgensen, Charlie Taylor, even Vince Lombardi for a year. But this has been a name that had been in existence since 1937. And now Dan Snyder, who hadn't caved, is caving in to be politically correct in some people's eyes. Here's an interesting thing, though. They took two surveys, Ronnie, in 2004 and 2016, albeit it might be flawed, with Native Americans, and said, are you offended by the name Redskins?
They didn't care.
In both cases, overwhelmingly, the answer was no. So why the change now?
Why the change now?
No.
This is really simple. This is as simple as the shot on your head tonight. The simple
I got some sweat. Look at that.
Wow, it's getting warm. The simple answer to this is the fact that when FedEx, who has the naming rights
Absolutely.
To their stadium until 2035 or something like that, when FedEx, as soon as FedEx said you need to change this name, all at once, Daniel Snyder is politically correct.
Right.
It's all money, just like everything. It's all money.
Yeah, it changes.
That's the reason Dan Snyder changed.
I can understand maybe the logo coming down, but if the Native Americans, for the most part, are not offended by the name Redskins and they look at it as some sort of tribute,
I think you would find that more offensive, Redskins, than the Chief Wahoo, for crying out loud. I would think so. I don't know.
We want to give a special thanks to our special guest, Basil. Great. And,
thank you, Basil.
No doubt he'll be coming back to concert again, and Ron will provide the answers to the mystery challenge next week, and we'll have another guest on. Our thanks to our executive producer, Mr. Bill Sheets, for keeping things neat and tidy today. Thank you for watching.
Thanks, Bill.
And we'll be back next week with another episode of Altered States with Mr. Sports and Ron Fantone. Take care. Have a great week.